Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Distinguished guests, your excellencies, my lord and ladies and gentlemen. I am happy to note that by some kind of an obscure clairvoyance, the president of the council appears to know what I'm going to speak about this evening. So I hadn't told him that, and one of the reasons for that is because I did not quite know what I was going to talk about. I do hope that I do now. But as it happens, I wanted, for obvious reasons, to begin with the Milad-un-Nabi. To start with, just to say something very obvious, that it has a great significance for Muslims, and that it is commemorated by Muslims, not just in our times today, but over a very long time in history, and not just in one place, but throughout the Muslim world. But I wanted to raise the question, what is the significance, or what could be the significance, rather, of an event like that? And it is, I think, worth noting, to begin with, that we say that we commemorate it. Now, the word commemorate, obviously, is related to memory, and therefore, the idea of remembering, of recalling. But obviously, it is not something that is part of our memory in the literal sense. And I say that because it helps us, it helps to take us into the issue of the nature of time. And that issue of the nature of time captures, in some respect, the difference that there is between modernity and traditional cultures. Because there are at least two kinds of time. There is the time of the calendar, and there is the time of the soul. And when it comes to the time of the soul, the relationship between present, past, and future alters in a way that undercuts the serial nature of time, which is the time that is most emphasized in modernity. So that the relationship between yesterday and today and tomorrow, which is characteristic of modern culture, is a relationship that alters. If we recall Augustine, who famously said about time, "What is time? I know what it is so long as I am not asked. But once I am asked and I have to speak about it, I have to describe it, I don't know anymore what it means." And Augustine also went on to say that the most fugitive, the most elusive aspect of time is the present. Because the past is what has gone, the future is what will come, what might come. The present, the moment I think about it, has become the past. And therefore, the present is always eluding one. So if one were now to talk about, to think about commemorating the Milad of the Prophet, one is really talking about memory or remembrance in a very special sense, because it is a sense that belongs entirely to the present. Let us say that the past is, at the most, what we might call the sense of the past. Now, the sense of the past is important because it is part of the communities of faith. All communities of faith have a sense of the past which is vital to them. And I always find it personally rather lamentable that in this great country, where there used to be a strong sense of the past, a strong sense of history, a sense of tradition, and an emphasis on the history of this country being taught in schools, one finds, or one suspects at least, that that is being eroded. One also finds in European cities that while the monuments and the architectural vestiges that you see there have a past which contains both, holds both the Greek tradition as well as the Judeo-Christian and in some respects, important respects in places like Spain, the Islamic tradition, that that history is only embedded in these monuments of stone and wood and of architectural shape and design, but that it is not always present in the consciousness. So that in France, for instance, the secular education system does not allow the teaching of its own Christian past. Now, these are very big issues, and I'll touch upon them again. So, in looking back, which is actually looking into the present of the Milad, one has to ask oneself, what is the nature of its significance? There is a very traditional answer to that, which is that the Prophet was a paradigm. He's an example. His behavior, his life is an example to Muslims. And as an exemplar, he inspires Muslims through the generations. Now, that is correct as a formulation, but it is only a formulation. I think if we explore that a little farther and look into it a little deeper, then we are likely to find that there are more difficult questions that face us. To begin with, we are dealing here with two very different times and with two very different worlds, the world of today and the world in which the Prophet lived and worked. If you ignore that difference, if we were to ignore the chasm that lies between these two worlds, between these two periods, then I think very serious problems arise. And some of what we call fundamentalism, it's a very broad word and it's often used too sweepingly, but part of it is the notion, whatever it is, which ignores this chasm, this huge difference that lies between our world and that world of that time. So the other reason why I think that the simple formulation that the Prophet is an exemplar for our times, that it is something where we should not stop, is simply so as to not to let our minds run off and not to let our minds be lazy. Because laziness, I think, is a sin. It ought to be more than a sin. It ought to be probably a crime. And of the two crimes that laziness is, which is physical laziness and mental laziness or intellectual laziness I find to be much more serious. Because it is controllable to an extent that physical laziness is not. So there is that aspect of the need to probe deeper. And the reason for that, I think, is because I would even go on to say that when we think about the Prophet, we think about tradition, we think about religion, we think we know, and I would say there is probably a need, a strong need, to put all these notions aside, to put the notion of religion aside, to put the notion of tradition and all the traditional vocabulary that we have to the side. I always say that in Islamic matters, one wishes that there was a kind of a drug which would produce selective amnesia. And if there was a drug of that kind possible, then if we had an amnesia of the word Islam, I think that could be all to the good. Because once the word was forgotten, we might be able to experience anew and afresh the realities, the phenomena, which the word itself, in the way it is used, tends to obscure. The trouble here is with the categories that we use, the concepts that we use, because they can be tyrannical. And once certain concepts and certain words master you and hold you in your grip, then you cannot see beyond them. It is like some of those, like those diagrams that you get in children's textbooks. You know, you have sometimes those diagrams where if you look at it from one way, you see the face of a person, and from another point of view, it is a vase. And once you see it in one or the other way, it's very hard for the mind to forget it because it grabs you and it sticks in your mind. And that is the kind of thing that happens with theological categories as well. So, to start with, I would like simply to put some questions to ourselves. One of them is, how are we to understand the world in which we live today? And how, in living in the world in which we live today, can we hope to understand the very different world that belongs to the time of the Prophet? If we do succeed in understanding this very different world from ours, can it somehow serve us as a means to understand or do something with the world in which we live? I raise this question because, you know, I remember an expression of the philosopher Paul Ricard: to come to oneself via the other. And that's a very rich idea. It happens in friendships. It happens in human relationships, that who I am becomes clearer when I speak to the other. In my very process of articulation with the other and the exchange, the interchange that happens with the other person, provided, of course, that the other person remains autonomous, because too many people want the other person to be a copy of themselves. But provided that the other person retains their own autonomy, is allowed to do that, then I grow as a result of that exchange or that interchange. And that is something which lies at the basis of pluralism, which is of which, you know, we justly and rightly place importance today. So coming back to oneself through the other, that is a question. How can we do that in looking at the Prophet? So what I'm suggesting is that we get away from the traditional way of thinking about the Prophet simply as an example, but to say what kind of questions arise in the intellectual act of seeking to relate to him and to his time. So that's a question. It doesn't necessarily have an immediate answer, but then we must always, I think it's worth remembering what the rabbi said, that there are two kinds of people around. There are those people who only have questions and no answers, and there are people who have only answers and no questions. Have those two types of people around us all the time in our experience. I don't know which is worse. The first type can be those who have only questions, can be exasperating. But those who have only answers are deadly. They are insufferable. And theology happens to be full of them. So one of the issues that I would say, one of the things that one has to do is perhaps to try and reconnect with the Quran, with the Prophet, in a way which is other than theological. And I want to make a few suggestions tonight about how that can be done. Now, I referred to the contemporary world. And I will say about the contemporary world very quickly that I want to focus on the challenges. And if I do that, if I focus on the challenges, it is not because I am an anti-modernist or because I think that the modern world and the Western world is bad, because it's has been a great civilization. But I want to make certain observations of a negative kind for the sake of balance. And I'll come to that issue quickly, why we need to make those kinds of observations. But if one were to begin by looking at some of the challenges that our societies in the modern world face, there is, to start with, as you know, the economic crisis that has just happened. And in talking about the economic crisis, I was reminded of a paragraph which I read many years ago in John Maynard Keynes, who makes this interesting observation. I cannot now trace it, but I do remember it vividly. So I'm going to paraphrase it because I'm quoting from memory. But he says that everything that he says, and it's a big book, that everything that he has been discussing there about economic policies is basically to get societies to the level where they can be comfortable and secure so that they can stand back, sit back, and be able to afford to think about the real great issues of human life, the issues of art, religion, ethics, and literature. Now, that is an inspiring passage, but it is the view of a bourgeois gentleman economist insofar as it separates the two into two phases. That there is an economic phase which takes one to a certain stage, after which one attends to these great issues of life like art and religion and science and so on. Whereas I think if one looks at reality, we find that they are inseparable, and that the way that modern economics prefers to base itself exclusively on quantified, mathematical, utilitarian reason is part of the economic crisis that we see. And this is something that I think needs to be taken up. education is the other area where there are great challenges. In an increasingly technical world, where education has the pressure to become technical, there is always the question of the place for humanistic, what used to be called humanistic development, which is necessary for citizenship. Where does that come from? And how does one preserve, if it is important to preserve, which I think it is, the distinction between information, knowledge, and wisdom? That's partly what humanities is all about. Universities are often afflicted with the problem of specialism. That's where you get what somebody said was the difference between Oxford and Cambridge universities, where apparently in one of those places, I don't know which, but it doesn't matter, one learns more and more about less and less, whereas at the other place, one learns less and less about more and more. That's why you say it doesn't matter whether you remember it is, whether it's Oxford or Cambridge. But that's the educational issue. Then there is the question of modern technology. And I think it is entirely mind-boggling when you look at what technology can now do in matters of genetic engineering, design with cloning that is possible, and people talking about immortality and designer babies and so on. That what kind of, what sort of human understanding of human nature and the place of humanistic values, of values such as spiritual humility, which must concern communities of faith, how is that going to be founded and supported? This is actually an old idea. It's not a new idea. It's only that technology makes it possible today. But with the Enlightenment 300 years ago in Europe, we got the idea of what is called the perfectibility of man, or the perfectibility of the human estate on earth, which is a notion which is very ironic, because we see that those 300 years produced anything but a path towards perfection. But it remains for us a question mark. There are, in this whole issue of modernity, if you look deeper, there are dogmas. So that there are dogmas of modernity, just as there are dogmas of religion. And let me give you a very quick example of one of the dogmas of modernity. You see, one of the trends today in the modern sciences, neuroscience in particular, but also genetics. In genetics, there is a notion that we have unraveled the secret of life, that we now know for sure the chemical basis of life to the extent that it becomes possible, it will become possible to predict what a particular individual's makeup will be like. Now, in reality, and I'm speaking now not on my own authority, obviously, but the authority of a fair amount of reading and conversations that I've had, because it is a field that interests me, that the reality is very different. And what we know about genetics is that there is always a reverse effect on our genes from our exchanges with the environment. So that the environment, the experience that one has from the environment is an experience that dictates the kind of proteins that are going to be transcribed or not to be transcribed from the DNA, and it affects it. So that life is in a way a dialectic. It is a two-way process. But that complexity is forgotten and ignored in popular notions of genetic progress. So that is one of the dogmas of modernity. And when we talk about modernity, one has to remember that the word is, to start with, tricky, because it has two meanings. One is present day, simply a neutral description of the present day. The other sense of modern is being up to date, of being progressive, of being advanced, of even being rational, because there is an old tradition in modern world of modernity being equal to rational. And the notion of what we call the Middle Ages. The Middle Ages were innocent of the idea of Middle Ages. The Middle Ages never had, obviously, a notion of themselves as Middle Ages. It is modernity which produced the notion of Middle Ages, and along with that, the notion that it was primitive It was an age full of superstitions and so on. You find that in Gibbon, you find that in Voltaire and other writers of the Enlightenment. And I think associated with that, also the notion that modern is synonymous with Western. That I think it is one of the most remarkable victories of the Western Hemisphere over the rest of the world, and something that has been stronger and deeper, it's penetrated much deeper into our psyche than the military triumphs of imperial expansion. And it has caused millions upon millions of people to take for granted that Western and modern are synonymous. And because it is taken for granted, we ought to ask a question about that. So these are the sort of things. I mean, in China, they are now talking about a model of a modernity which is other than Western. Whether that has substance or not, I don't know. But I always remember in this context what T.S. Eliot once said about democracy, which is another notion that needs much finer and finely nuanced treatment than it is given nowadays. T.S. Eliot, who said that in the times in which we live, democracy has come to its full tide, democratic individualism has come to its full tide, and it is more difficult now to be an individual than it ever was before. Because he was talking about the pressure from the masses. The mass media were not yet in his day as pervasive and as powerful as they have now become. So, this notion, can somebody tell me what, because I didn't look at my watch when we started, and I think we, pardon? Okay. So let me then quickly make two points. Why is it that it is important to address the modern world in our thoughts? It is because I would say that there has to be in human societies a relationship between the conditions of the world, the material conditions of the world, and the thought forms, the cultural forms, which are part of that world. In other words, between world and worldview. There has to be that fit. Because without it, we have a problem. I remember many, many years ago, to bring this, to give a concrete example, when I was a lecturer at the University of Nairobi, the caterer, the head caterer was responsible for the students' catering, was found to be pocketing the allowance that he was given. And that came out after the students rioted, because, you know, students often riot for food. That was one of those waves of student riots over food, or the quality of food that they were getting. And when they investigated it, they found that this caterer had been pocketing the money, so that they were getting third grade coffee, and the potatoes they were getting were not really potatoes, and so on. Now, the interesting thing about that was the vice chancellor of the university sent away that head caterer from the university on a paid leave of absence, a long, indefinite paid leave of absence. And I was talking to a Dutch sociologist who, I don't mean to be unkind, but who was otherwise unmemorable, but I remember him for the explanation that he gave me. Because I asked him once, I said, what puzzles me is that if you go into the street of Nairobi, and this used to happen, if somebody snatched a handbag or a wallet from you, you didn't have to wait for the police to arrive, because the crowds, the mob, went after him, and they were brutal. They would catch hold of the person and kick him and beat him mercilessly and violently, so that when the police arrived, they saw it as their first task to protect the thief rather than arrest him. Now, I said to this sociologist, I said, how does it happen that you get that phenomenon on one side, and on the other side, you get this man who has been found to have carried out theft to be sent on paid long leave? And he said, that is because in African traditional cultures, theft is a notion that makes sense only in physical terms. You have something in your pocket or you are carrying it and somebody seizes it from you, that is theft. But when you fiddle with books and accounts, that is not perceived as theft because it is not part of the customary, the traditions in which the ethics and the values have evolved. So here, clearly there was a gap between modernity, the realities of the modern world, and the ethical culture that the society was coming from. Now, very quickly, you know, with that notion, I want to return to the issue of the prophet. And one of the things that a scholar at Edinburgh called Montgomery Watt many years ago showed, there is some controversy about that, but doesn't matter, the broad outlines of it I think are correct, that what happened in the time of the prophet was that there was a great socio-economic change. The nomad from a nomadic economy to a mercantile economy. And in that change, in that transition, there wasn't a corresponding moral and intellectual and religious change. And what you find in the prophet is that he addresses that, and the Quran addresses that. Because there is a moral vacuum. When all tribal solidarities have broken down, and instead you have a mercantile economy, and merchants tend to be individualists, and therefore there was a deficit in social solidarity. And what the prophet and the revelation provides is a new kind of an umbrella, a new kind of a unity, which is not individualistic and which is not tribal in the old way, but which is more universal. And I've said this in a very short way, but it is a big issue. If we examine that carefully, then we realize, to start with, that what Fazlur Rahman says, that the prophet's work was for moral reform. I don't find that convincing, because the word reform, I think it was not a revolution. Now, it wasn't a revolution because the prophet is always appealing to something that has been lost. The Quran is always talking about old values which have been forgotten. So it's not a revolution which seeks to start with a clean slate. But on the other hand, it's not reform. I rather think that a better word is reformation, with a hyphen between the re and the formation. It is a reformation of the society. And if that is what it is, then I think that there is an exact analogy that is available to us in thinking about the modern world, because it is an analogous process that is needed. You see, the prophet takes action. And I think there is a whole book to be written about the concept of action, because action is a very important element in human culture. It is one of those things that distinguishes human beings from the biological facts, from nature, from animal life. You know, this was in traditional societies, there was always a distinction made, you know, what is special to human beings. It is something that we don't do too much of now for good reasons, because of animal welfare and about environment and so on. We are more conscious of continuities rather than discontinuities. But it is supremely human to take an action, because in action, the genius of a human, the human spirit, the freedom of the human spirit is exercised in action. When the lion goes out on a hunt, it, if you observe it, the way it hunts its prey, it is very artful, but it is not art, because it is guided entirely by instinct. And the skill that is exercised is impressive, but it is an instinctive skill. Whereas art, like action, is entirely free and performed as a testimony to the human spirit. Now, what is most interesting about the Prophet's action is that there is a unity, there is an action on one side, and there is the word, which is the word of the Quran, the word of revelation. And what that word does is that it gives a meaning to the action. It describes the action, it rationalizes it, it justifies it, it spells out its consequences. When there are setbacks, it consoles, as in the ayat that was recited. When action is still needed, it inspires, it encourages. And that unity is something that I think in the modern rationality has been broken, because we tend to think of the intellect. See, when we talk about the prophetic intellect, we have a hurdle, we have an obstacle, which is that the modern notion of intellect does not comprehend the kind of intellect that we see at work in the career of the Prophet. Howard Gardner, who is a psychologist at Harvard University, wrote a book in which, in the modern context, he pointed out that there are multiple intelligences and there isn't one kind of an intellect. So there is linguistic intelligence, which is the intelligence of a speaker or a writer. There is the mathematico-logical intelligence, which is the intelligence of a scientist or the technician. There is the bodily kinesthetic intelligence of a dancer. There is musical intelligence, because no one can say that there is not no intelligence in Mozart, for instance, but it is an intelligence of sound and form and the logic of composition. So there are there is personal intelligence, which businessmen at their best have it, and politicians ought to have it, which is the capacity to deal intelligently with personalities, with the characters of people. So the whole notion of intellect is opened up when we reflect on the Prophet. All right, so I don't want to take too much of your time, but if I may, I'll just, in finishing, make two or three remarks. One is, I wanted to remind us of what Max Weber said. Max Weber was a great thinker who admired the accomplishments of the modern world, but at the same time was very apprehensive of where it might lead. And he says, these are his words, "No one knows who will live in this cage in the future, or whether at the end of this tremendous development, entirely new prophets will arise, or there will be a great rebirth of the old ideas and ideals, Or if neither takes place, then mechanized petrification will occur. For this last stage of this cultural development, it might truly be said, specialists without spirit, sensualists without heart. This nullity imagines that it has attained a level of civilization never achieved before. You see, when I talk about the need for religious communities, communities of faith, to engage with modernity, the idea is not that they should succumb to modernity, but that it is only by having affection and a sense of involvement and an investment in the modern world and in the world in which we live, the countries in which we live, it is only by having a stake in them that we can earn the right to be critical of them. And that criticism does not have to come from outside. It is part of the Western tradition itself, which is what these words show. I think that because we are here at the Ismaili Centre, and I must thank the Ismaili Council not just for inviting me to talk, but for having this kind of event, because this kind of an event is a true tribute to the memory of the Prophet, because it is an intellectual tribute. It is a tribute in which we are honoring the intellect rather than the traditional ritual celebration of it. Since this is the Ismaili Center, I was reminded of what professed the late Professor Graba, who was a great art historian, said about the Aga Khan award for architecture, of which he had been a very important person from the beginning. He said that as he's speaking about His Highness the Aga Khan, he said, as he related it to me in an interview in 2001, the Aga Khan had become concerned with what he called a process of cultural erosion in the Muslim world, in which values, including aesthetic ones, were drowned in a sea of thoughtless modernity. And that's part of the theme, the principle that I wanted to make. And very lastly now, speaking about the Prophet and about the Quran. Many, many years ago, when I was a student of English literature, I came across a little article in an anthology that we were supposed to read. It wasn't singled out for our reading, but it was entitled Losing the Bible. And it has stuck in my mind. It has been very powerful. And therefore, I will read out from what that little-known article says about the Bible, because I think it sums up some of the issues about the disconnection between a society and its own spiritual roots. He says, the Bible is a living book, like Homer and Shakespeare, and like them, is interpreted afresh every few generations. It embodies permanent truths and deals with questions that have always engaged great writers: the meaning of the universe, life and death, the relationship of men with men and with their God. In our day, it is a bestseller. This was written in the 1980s. I don't think 20 years later that is still true, but I may be wrong. In our day, it is a bestseller, but unread. A dust-thick classic, partly because our hard-backed scientific notions dismiss the Bible as a religious text. There is something impressive and memorable in its varied styles, which signifies that what is being said with such force and clarity and vitality is worth attending to. If it is lost, all of us will be culpable, and especially those engaged in education at every level. Through its neglect, we are losing a piece of our history and foregoing what should be an element of our consciousness. Now, I think that those sentiments about the Bible can be taken much more generally, about history, about the tradition, about the Quran. And I think religious communities, and this is where these issues are not just solely Muslim, they involve the Muslim world, they involve the secular world, and the Jewish and Christian and other religious communities, that could be one of the common tasks for the future. Thank you very much.